Good morning, and welcome to worship here at Brenham Presbyterian Church. And whether you're a member of our congregation or a visitor here, please be very welcome to our worship this morning online. There's a lot going on in the life of the church, and we'll get to that a little bit later. But for now, let us prepare our hearts and minds for God by listening to our prelude this morning. Listen then to the call to worship from 1 Chronicles this morning. Then David blessed the Lord in the presence of all the assembly, and David said, "Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of our ancestor Israel, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, are the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and on the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and it is in your hand to make great and to give strength to all. And now, our God, we give thanks to you and praise your glorious name." Let us open our worship service then with our first opening hymn, "God of Ages, Whose Almighty Hand."
Thank you.
Let us pray. We come with gladness, loving God, and drawn by our need and by a desire to praise you and give thanks. Enlighten the eyes of our hearts that we may be full of hope. Enlarge the circle of our concern that we may see the stranger as next of kin, the hungry person as part of our own family, the one who is sick as a whole individual deserving our care. Grant us the presence of Christ that we may learn more fully to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us therefore confess our sins before God and one another, first using the unison prayer of confession you'll find in your bulletin this morning. Together, merciful God, in your gracious presence, we confess our sin and the sin of this world. Although Christ is among us as our peace, we are a people divided against ourselves as we cling to the values of a broken world. The profit and pleasures we pursue lay waste the land and pollute the seas. The fears and jealousies that we harbor set neighbor against neighbor and nation against nation. We abuse your good gifts of imagination and freedom, of intellect and reason, and have turned them into bonds of oppression. Lord, have mercy upon us. Heal and forgive us. Set us free to serve you in the world as agents of your reconciling love. In Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let us continue with silent prayers of confession. Let us pray. Friends, even in the time of trial, God sees our affliction and the affliction of others. Even in times of despair, God does not desert us, but rather forgives all who truly repent. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please bow your head for our prayer for illumination. Eternal God, whose kingdom flows from the power of the Holy Spirit, enlighten our hearts and minds so that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may each and all come to see what we need to do to spread your grace. Amen. Could we have the young disciples to come forward this morning? Come closer to the TV screen or the computer screen or your iPad, whatever you are participating in worship in this morning. Please come forward. Well, have you ever wondered who God holds in his hands? Have you ever wondered, you know, whether God holds, well, what does God hold in his hands? Well, we all know that Jesus came to us. He is the Son of God. He is God. And here is a picture I wanted to share with you. Who is Jesus holding there? An itty-bitty baby, huh? He's got the itty-bitty baby in his hand. Jesus, you see, cares for little bitty children. He has the babies in his hand. Well, what about when children get older? Like maybe some of you are. Well, you know what? This picture here shows that. Look at that. A little older child there, but he's being held by the hands of God in Jesus Christ. Look at that. Jesus is kissing him and holding him in the palm of his hand. And are children the only things that God holds in his hand? Why, no. You know, God loves animals too. We just had a blessing of the animals a few weeks ago, and here's a picture of Jesus holding a puppy dog. Because you see, God loves all the little animals as much as God loves children or you and me, because you see, God created all of those animals and you and me. As a matter of fact, God has everything in God's hands. Did you know that? You should turn it right side up. God has everything. The whole world is in God's hands. In fact, if you look closely at this picture, you can see all the stars and planets and whirling galaxies. God has everything in God's hand. Because you see, boys and girls, God loves and cares for everything in this universe that God made. Let us bow our heads and pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, dear Holy Spirit, dear Jesus, thank you for holding me in the palm of your hand. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for caring for me. Thank you for loving the whole world. Amen. Thank you. We come to our scripture readings this morning. We finish our series on the Lord's Prayer from the Gospel of Matthew. So we'll read Matthew 6, verses 9 through 13. Jesus is speaking. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Here's the line we're going to focus on this morning. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. Now, other ancient Greek manuscripts add the following line. We know this one from the traditional form of the Lord's Prayer. And it adds this line. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. From the book of James, chapter 1, verses 13 through 14. The author writes, no one, when tempted, should say, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one. But one is tempted by one's own desire, being lured and enticed by it. And finally, doing this a bit in reverse order, we're going to read from the book of Genesis, chapter 37, verses 3 through 11, the well-known story of Joseph, the son of Jacob. Now Israel, that's another name for Jacob, now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Once Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, listen to this dream that I dreamed. There we were binding sheaves to the field. Suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, and then your sheaves gathered around and bowed down to my sheaf. His brothers said to him, are you indeed to reign over us? Are you indeed to have dominion over us? So they hated him even more because of his dreams and his words. He had another dream and told it to his brothers, saying, look, I've had another dream. The sun, the moon, and 11 stars are bowing down to me. But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, what kind of dream is this that you have had? Shall we indeed come, I and your mother and your brothers, and bow down to the ground before you? So his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I think that one of the most difficult things we learn growing up is that we will always face trials of one sort or another in our lives. Some trials are self-imposed, such as the trial of breaking one's personal best in some sporting event like track. Some trials are self-imposed. But other trials are imposed upon us. The trials brought about by an illness, or the trials brought about to a community in the wake of some natural disaster or other type of disaster. Such trials are not things we choose, but we're caught up in them anyway. But one way or another, trials come our way and we are called upon to face them. And trials bring about opportunities. In self-imposed trials, we have the opportunity to push ourselves, be better than we ever thought we could be, do better than we ever thought we could. My high school track coach pushed us all the time to strive, to beat our best time, to jump higher, go faster, to do better, work harder for ourselves and for the team. Those were trials that we chose. But even in trials that we do not choose, we have the opportunity to rise above difficulties, come together and work together, seek the common good and common goals. Even if it means some individual sacrifices, and even for a time, some discomfort. Trials in life, whether self-imposed or due to circumstances outside of ourselves, bring opportunities. But if trials bring opportunities, well, they also bring temptations. You know, we see that with doping scandals in professional sports. We've seen it in the cheating scandals that get wealthy kids into colleges that they really didn't qualify for, depriving some other deserving person of that slot. We see temptations crop up in community trials. For example, in the time of pandemic, we see the temptation of profiteering. We've seen it. These individuals hoarding PPEs and other supplies needed on the front lines of this pandemic. Indeed, this whole pandemic is a trial. And the temptations it presents to us are more than profiteering, but in fact, they are legion. The point is that wherever there's a time of trial, temptation is near, whispering in the ear, urging the easy path, the shortcut, the uplifting of self-interest to govern all. Now, I think that no one was more aware of this than Jesus. Indeed, his instructions this morning regarding prayer take this tension between trials on the one hand and temptations on the other very seriously. We read that in our gospel reading this morning. This line from the Lord's Prayer is presented by Matthew. And do not bring us to the time of trial. This is a petition to God. Do not bring us to the time of trial. Now, this line is not so much about self-imposed trials as it is the kind of trials that bring on tribulations and difficulties. It's a plea to God to save us from the times that try a person's soul. Illness, failure, wildfires, earthquakes, hurricanes, pandemics, those times that try a person's very spirit, their very soul. Now, I want to say that it is right to ask God to save us from such things, to petition God to save us from such trials. I do it. We all do it. Some form of a prayer that says, Lord, please don't let this happen or that happen to me, to my child, to my grandchild. Listen, I prayed such prayers during the time that my daughter, Caitlin, was in labor and then in surgery. I prayed for a safe, healthy grandson born a month early, prematurely. And we were all in a time of trial. And I asked God, please don't make it more so. And God was gracious. It all came out okay. The time of trial passed, and we were not brought into greater trial. You see, it's perfectly right and natural to ask that the angel of trials and tribulations to pass us by, and to be grateful, prayerful, and joyful when it does. But times of trial sometimes do not pass us by. And such are the times in which we now live. And the temptations during these times, as I say, they are legion and they are real. time of temptations, during these times of trial, they are legion and they are real. In fact, our traditional Lord's Prayer renders this same line of scripture from Matthew this way: lead us not into temptation. Now here we have two translations of one Greek word, perosmon. It can translate as trial or temptation. And both of them are correct. It's not an either or, both of them correct. The word can mean trial or temptation. And while the meanings here are, well, related, there's just a bit of nuance that's worth looking at here. To be in a time of trial is one thing, but to be in a time of temptation, well, that's something else, isn't it? And temptation itself is a sort of trial, but there's a big difference in the shades of meanings here, I think. This is particularly true when we consider the whole line of the prayer from Matthew's scripture. It's a petition: Lord, do not bring us to the time of trial. Lord, do not bring us to the time of temptation. Or if we consider it using the more traditional phrasing, lead us not into the time of trial. Lead us not into trial. Lead us not into temptation. This one word carries a bit of a difference in meaning, does it not? Depending upon which definition from the Greek one wants to use. And yet the word carries both meanings, I think, at the same time. And maybe therein lies the tension. For as I just said, trials carry the possibility of temptation, and succumbing to temptations often lead to more trials. So we'd like to avoid both. So we pray to God that we not be presented with either or both. We don't want trials and we don't want temptations, and sometimes they pass us by and sometimes not. And now at this point, I want to tackle something that I'm going to start by saying I don't have the full answer to, but I feel like it must be addressed this morning. And that's this question: does God really lead us, bring us into the time of temptation? Does God lead us into temptation? This is an old theological question, and one that's caused heartburn for so many. Indeed, recently, Pope Francis took the unprecedented step of suggesting that the Catholic Church change the traditional wording of this line, because as a theologian, he simply does not believe that God would lead us, bring us into a time of temptation. Now, my friends, while I may disagree as a Protestant with Francis on many things, in this, I agree with our brother in Christ. God does not lay in wait like some sort of trickster to lead us into temptation just to see what we'll do. God's not some kind of cosmic mad scientist running an experiment on us. No. Indeed, the Apostle James, I think, says this very clearly this morning. No one, when tempted, should say, "I am being tempted by God," for God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one. He himself tempts no one. Now, there are numerous examples of this in life and in the Bible. I give you just one this morning in this story of Joseph and his tumultuous relationship with his father, his parents, and most of all, his brothers. Now, this is a well-known story if you've ever been to Sunday school. Joseph's brothers already dislike him, hate him, the scriptures say, because their father, Israel, that is Jacob, loves Joseph as a child of his old age. He's showing preference to this younger son. And his brothers hate him. You know, the temptation to hate someone, because another who's important in your life seems to love them more, that temptation is very powerful. Ask any family therapist. Of course, Joseph, for his part, he just can't resist the temptation to rub everybody's nose in it, can he? It just rubs everyone's nose in it. He has a series of dreams which will eventually come true. But he has to lord it over his brothers and even his parents. Wow, talk about a family in time of trial. But let's be clear here. God did not make the decision to force everyone in the story to succumb to the temptations presented by parental favoritism or sibling rivalry and unbridled egotism. Everyone in this story was perfectly capable of doing that all by themselves. And so they did, leading to the near murder of a brother and more. But you see, all that was not God's doing. Indeed, later in life, a much older and wiser Joseph, speaking to his brothers, will sum it up well. You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. The evil came from the actions of Joseph's brothers, and indeed from Joseph himself, but God used it for good. God is not the author of evil, nor is God the author of temptation. God is the author of good. Okay, preacher, if not God, then who is the author of temptation? Well, the Lord's Prayer actually seems to contemplate two sources. The first is just sort of evil as a general, almost abstract principle. We hear that in our traditional Lord's Prayer. It says, but deliver us from evil. But Matthew's Gospel reads, but rescue us from the evil one. What's interesting here is that, the Lord's Prayer in the traditional form, it emphasizes evil in general, while Matthew's Gospel emphasizes an individual, the evil one. And here's the thing, the Greek is the same. It's the same Greek. It can be actually translated either way. It can be translated where it refers to evil in the abstract, or it can be translated to emphasize evil personally. Now, my friends, we know that evil exists as an abstract principle. Doctrines and forms of government which destroy people, such as white supremacy, are evil in the abstract. But of course, in history, they have become evil in the concrete. Slavery, fascism, Nazism, these are evil ideas that found historical expression, causing the misery and murder of millions. But what about this evil one? Who or what is that? Well, it's most often associated with some personification of evil, a fallen angel, Satan, or Lucifer, or the devil. And it is true that the Bible, even Jesus, sometimes makes reference to such personified forms of evil. But my friends, I think we need to be very, very careful about this, because you know, it's easy to blame some devil for what is plain old fallen human-sourced evil. It's easy to blame the devil for what we ourselves do. Again, in the Joseph story this morning, you can't blame the devil for all the evil things that took place, like plotting to kill your brother and then settling him off to some passing slavers. The devil didn't make them do that. They made that decision. Furthermore, I think that too much concentration on some supernatural force of evil gives too convenient a scapegoat for human failings and follies. It also generates fear way out of proportion. You know, down through the ages, the devil has been used as an excuse for all kinds of evils. It was used to burn outspoken women as witches here in the American colonies, and it was used as an excuse to slaughter natives in North, Central, and South America. I don't think that Jesus wants us to concentrate on a personified form of evil with a name. Because if Jesus wanted us to focus our prayers on being saved from the devil or Satan or something like that, it seems to me the prayer would have said so expressly. But it doesn't. It leaves it kind of vague. Or at least ambiguous. But could it be that in some cases, the evil one really is ourselves? That part of what the one referred to is all too often us. James puts it this way this morning, but one is tempted by one's own desires, being lured and enticed by it. Shakespeare may have had the right of it. From the play Julius Caesar, Mark Antony is speaking and says, "The evil that men do lives after them, but the good is often tarred with the bones." Indeed, temptation can lead to evil, of course. But not all temptations are equal. The temptation to eat a second piece of chocolate cake is not nearly the same thing as succumbing to the temptation to injure or kill another person in an emotional rage. But succumbing to some temptations in the time of trial, they can certainly have bad effects, even harmful ones. In the time of trial, maybe we should all pray for the wisdom to make good choices, hard as they are, choices that benefit and protect the whole community and the individuals in it. And my friends, that is not easy. Especially in these trying times, these times of trial and temptation. It's just not easy. And we can feel like that we're just not in control. Indeed, there's a line that's found in some ancient Greek manuscripts, a line that was added by early church leadership, and we find it in our traditional Lord's Prayer today. And so down through the centuries, when we say the Lord's Prayer is this line, "For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Indeed, the kingdom of God belongs to God. The power and the glory are God's forever. Such belongs to God and proceeds from God. Real kingship and real leadership, real power, real glory, they all proceed from God. And they're not just a possession. They're part of who God is. And in these trying times, these times of trial and temptation, it's a great comfort to know, to believe, that the kingdom, the power, and the glory all reside with the very one who was tempted as we are, but who said no. That for him, power and glory, we were not weapons to be used, but grace and love to be applied to the hurts of the world. They are the power that will lead us out of temptation, grace and love. And you know what? I see that here at Brenham Presbyterian Church. I see it witnessed every day in the work to bring safe worship to the people, in the mission and ministries we continue to support with our time, our talents, and yes, our money, in our work in the Galilee Garden that continues to feed those in need in the name of Jesus Christ. And all of this and more, we pull together and we work together. Because you see, we believe that God is in control. And so we work and we pray and we strive. And together we affirm the final line from 1 Chronicles this morning in our opening. "And now, our God, we give thanks to you and praise to your glorious name." Even in a time of trial, even in a time of temptation, even in the time of COVID. May God bless you all. Amen. May the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord. Let us take a moment of silent reflection upon the word proclaimed. Amen. Please join me in the declaration of faith that is found in your worship bulletin this morning. Together. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, who alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children and healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. In sovereign love, God created the world good and makes everyone equally in God's image, male and female, of every race and people, to live as one community. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus." With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us listen to our musical reflection this morning. Hear, O my Lord, I see thee face to face. Let us bow our heads and hear the prayers of the people this morning. Let us pray. Lord God, in these difficult times, we pray for grace, for peace, for mercy, for an end to this terrible pandemic that has afflicted so many across the face of the globe. Give us courage and resoluteness to do the hard things that must be done. We pray for those on the front lines of this pandemic, for doctors and nurses, medical personnel, and first responders of all kinds. We pray for those who stock our grocery store shelves, deliver our packages, and in 1,000 different ways perform tasks that help to keep our society safe and working. We pray for those who have lost employment, whose futures are uncertain, whose trials seem overwhelming. Help us to be agents of your grace in such difficult days. And now, as you have taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Just a couple of minutes for mission this morning, focusing on Brenham Presbyterian Church this morning. Two things I would like to highlight. First is that we will be attempting an outdoor worship service, weather permitting, on the first Sunday in Advent, that's November the 29th at 11 a.m. We'll only have one worship service, Seating is limited, so if you would, please call Carla Collins and make a reservation if you would like to come. It will be socially distant and masked, but a time to try to come together outdoors. And it is not instead of the YouTube worship. YouTube worship will continue no matter what. It'll be essentially the same sermon. But if you'd like to come together outdoors safely, please do. It should be, I hope, an uplifting experience for everyone. And the second thing I would like to highlight is that I will be leading an Advent series. Together we'll be tackling Adam Hamilton's book, Incarnation, Rediscovering the Significance of Christmas. Adam Hamilton's work is well known to me. I think you'll find this uplifting and fun to do. We'll do it by Zoom on Monday evenings at 6 o'clock, November 30, December 7, 14, and 21, essentially the four Mondays in the season of Advent. You can get the book off of Amazon. It's a very, very short book, and the readings are very short. It'll be mostly discussion, and you can get it on Kindle as well. If you would like to participate, please also call Carla and register for that so we can send you the Zoom invitation out. These are just a few of the things that are going on still in the life of your church. Well, whether you're a visitor or a member here, if you have found anything of spiritual benefit this morning, we would invite you to share with us some of your financial resources to support the mission and the ministries of Brenham Presbyterian Church. This worship service is one of those. There are many people within our congregation and beyond our congregation who, for whatever reasons, feel much more comfortable worshiping online, and your tithes and offerings help to do that. If you would like to do that through a check, you may send a check to Brenham Presbyterian Church, 1005 Green Street, Brenham, Texas, 77833. That goes to a secure lockbox. And by the way, we are a nonprofit organization, and we're glad to send you a yearly statement for tax purposes. Or if you would like to give online, you can do that at our website at brenhampresbyterian.org/give. Your generosity is greatly appreciated. Now, during this time of COVID, we realize that many may not have financial resources to share, and we would never ask anyone to jeopardize their own well-being. And we don't want anyone to feel guilty. If you don't have financial resources to share at this time, we understand. And we would simply ask that you pray for the mission and ministries of Brenham Presbyterian Church. As we prayerfully consider how we can contribute, let us listen to our musical meditation this morning, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. As a benediction this morning, I would remind us again of this ancient line, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Those things do not belong to us. They come from God and they belong to God. We are but God's children and God's servants. We are called, brothers and sisters, in our mission and ministry in our lives to carry out ministries even in times of trial, even in times of temptation. And so I would charge you this week to remind someone else in some quiet way that God really is in control, that God holds us in the palm of his hand, and that God loves us. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Sisters and brothers in Christ, go in peace. Amen. Let us listen to our benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you, and the postlude.